pura cultura back in this bitch. Sin censura, baby. Let's go. I'm about to drop a freestyle, man. Y'all ain't even ready for this.
Let's get it, let's get it.
Ratchet bitches wanting for she's not Philippe. That's the type that put me in my mood.
Hey.
She know that I'm up, but she come cool for me. She know how to put me in my groove.
Okay.
I know it's a lot that you can learn from me. It's just one thing that you gotta prove. If you gotta walk with you to ride for me, I might need an extra foot or two. Gotta keep my distance, they surround me. I'ma need an extra foot or two.
I'm fucking
they
with this.
They might have to go and build a house for me. I'ma need an extra foot or
crib same size as the Galleria. Galleria. Spanish model with me, call her Senorita.
I
done fell in love with a hood girl. She be putting syrup in her margarita. Buy my college vibe a brand new Birkin. On the weekend, she be twerking. Take a shower in the Maybach, it got curtains.
Okay.
Your phone in your purse, you making me nervous.
He talking wild.
Done fresher than the turkey. I be clean. Got a crush on this waitress, hoe she serve me. Number 7, I'm a dog.
We got homies that don't even listen to hip hop right now being like, esa rola no está tan culera, güey. Sí, sí me late, güey.
They vibing with
sí
it.
Sí me late, güey.
21 Savage, güey. That vato's definitely doing his thing right now, bro. He they dropped that, him and Drake dropped that album or that, I would say it's
the
album.
Do Your Thing 21.
That's a dope album, bro. Drake and 21, good mixture, bro. You get kind of the best of both worlds, right? You get that more of that player vibe, and then you get that gangster shit too. So
but
I thought that
21
was
Savage is the proof in the pudding. No, but he's the proof that you do not need to be the crazy lyricist, and I'm saying that respectfully. You know what I'm saying? It's just the style that he says it in, way. It's just the mannerism that he flows that people fuck with it, way. He's not saying nothing that's never been said before, way. You know, like, he's not your Kendrick. He's not your Drake. Drake says he's real clever with his shit. He's real, you know.
I don't fuck with broke boys.
Drake was on Smiley's top, five of artists of the year,
probably on the majority of people's top five.
Not mine. Oh, not a real ones.
Yo, Chente was my number one, bro.
Okay,
don't get it twisted. That you can't get more Mexican than having Chente as your number one, bro.
I know you just did that purposely, way.
Nah,
you're trying to get people to think you's a real one out here.
I've been on my Mexican shit, bro.
You know, my number one artist was Lil Durk this year, way. I was on some grimy shit, man. They lucky they didn't fuck with me this year. I was ready to spin the block.
Now, we said this before, way, but it's like, you know that meme where you have that picture where it's like the bota and then you have the Air Force One?
That's a Latino's playlist or something?
That's
shit.
The best way you can explain a Mexican dude's playlist, or I guess my playlist, way. Like, it went from, this is what mine went from. It went from Chente to Drake to Key Glock to, I forgot the next person. and then it went to Los Angeles Azules.
You had Kendrick.
Oh yeah, Kendrick, Drake, and Key Glock.
Yeah, so you had Chente, Kendrick, Drake, Key Glock, and then
Los Angeles Azules. Wey.
And mine was Lil Durk, Romeo Santos. Can't think of that third one, man. That third one. Shit, let's get my list proper,
pull it out, man.
Let's say this shit correctly.
Yeah, we got the info right here. Might as well use it. So you have Lil Durk number one, Romeo Santos two, Los Gemelos de Sinaloa three, Key Glock four, and then Kevo. I never heard of Kevo.
He's a reggaeton dude. He's dope with it. You know, y'all fucking with Bad Bunny. I'm fucking with street cats out here, way.
Okay.
Del Corillo.
You're trying to get them before they go mainstream, I see.
You know what I'm saying, bro? What's it called? So the lists were dope, you know. And since we're talking about music, you know, we're a pura cultura. We is about the whole culture. But, you know, we are professionals in the music side of things, you know.
okay, okay.
Look at your list and look at my list, and what do they have in common? They have straight
Where are you and where am I?
Okay, okay. We have something in common. So Smiley's playlist, we just said, he has Chente, he has Drake, he has Kendrick, he has Drake. I think I just said that already. Anyways, Key Glock. I have Lil Durk. I have Romeo Santos. I have Los Gemelos de Sinaloa. What do we have in common? Spanish music and rap music. Mm-hmm. We need one Latino, preferably Mexican, for my own selfish reasons. We need a Mexican to be able to give us both of that, you know, in some way or another way. I know you can't mold somebody
you can't really do both. I mean, they're two different genres, way. But
look at the Latino. You said it's a meme. There's Botas, there's Forces, there's Henny, and there's Bucanas, way. You know, like, can we have someone that does both of them?
You don't need someone to do both, way. That's the beauty of music, way. You can like different genres, way. That's different music for different scenarios or different situations, way.
I'm just saying, way. We both listen to Mexican rappers, way. I'm not sure why none of them showed up on my top five, yeah. Way.
I think one of them that I would have thought would have popped up on mine would have been like the Mexican OT or Peso Peso, bro. I feel like I did listen to a lot of them. Or in Money Sign Suede. That motherfucker's dope.
Money Sign Suede. I listen to Bozo. I listen to Ilza Kill.
Oh, shout out to the homie.
You know what I'm saying? Kill, like, I listen to these vatos, way. I'm not sure why none of them popped up on my list, way. But that's just what it is.
It's been a different type of year.
Yeah, they doing their thing, though. So shout out to all the Mexican rappers that we fuck with, man, you know.
And while we're at it, shout out to everybody that shared your pictures, your posts about your Spotify playlist. Your Spotify playlist or your Spotify, I don't know, your results.
It's called Wrapped.
Okay, your Spotify rap showing that Pura Cultura was in your list. Shout out to the ones that had us number one. But, you know, obviously shout out to everyone that had us up in their top fives. Nothing but, you know, we appreciate that shit, man. Nothing but love for everyone sharing that. And I'm sure there's other people that you know, they don't be sharing like that, you know. But I'm sure we up there, man. I'm sure
keeping it 100 way, keeping it funky way. Even if we're on your top 10, you know what I'm saying? Even keeping us in that rotation, man. Appreciate all y'all.
For real.
And this year we're gonna go harder, man. Man, we're gonna go hard in these streets on this podcast game.
It was a tough year, man.
It was a different type of year, man.
Everybody knows, man. It's a different type of year, man. But shout out to everyone that stayed loyal to the podcast, stays rocking with the podcast. Yeah.
Shout out también to all the artists or other podcasters or other influencers or small businesses or just people that we rock with, way that we had to delay things, or we have to reschedule things, or we have to postpone when we want to do a collab or interviews and shit like that. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? And that's what I'm saying. Like this next coming year, you know, we're gonna go harder. We're gonna bring you guys every como se dice angle of the Latino influence, whether it's business, whether it's music, whether it's just fuck, even TikTokers, way. You know what I mean? We out here doing things, man. This year, people are gonna be able to meet people that we rock with, people that we fuck with, and just keep this shit popping, man. And shout out to all the Latino podcasters that we fuck with. You know, shout out to all the Latino podcasters that are out there. I see new names out there. I see new podcasts up. Man, shout out to them, man. You know what I'm saying?
Because
we need our Latino voices. We need our Latino influences. And, you know, we mentioned it last time on that George Lopez and Paul Rodriguez episode. We need for people to start understanding our Latino humor. It's different. You know what I'm saying? We some funny motherfuckers, way, but motherfuckers just don't get it.
We some funny motherfuckers in our own way.
In our own way. And people, people are going to start kind of understanding us. You know what I'm saying?
But it's our time, man. You know, we always say that, but it's like, because it's like a snowball effect. You know, it just keeps growing and growing. I think Latino comedians are on the rise. Latino podcasts are on the rise. Latino hip hop is on the rise. Latino actors and Latino shows is on the rise. But it's like,
yeah,
we're consistently moving forward in every aspect of the entertainment of the industry way. So it's nothing but it's nothing but dope way. It's just dope to see everyone winning in their own way, in their own lane, and of course, way, you know, everyone that's supporting, you know, everyone in each different industry, each different avenue, because at the end of the day, way, nobody would be nowhere if people weren't watching the shows, if people weren't listening, yeah, to the podcast, if people weren't listening to the music, if people weren't going to the show. So at the end of the day, shout out to everyone that's consciously or subconsciously supporting Latino platforms, man. So shout out to you guys, man.
Yeah. Facts.
But man, yeah, man, it's been a busy time of the year, way. Busy time of the year. A lot of things have been going on. Everyone already knows that.
I heard you were Black Friday shopping, bro. You were waiting in line for 5 hours, wait, to get a $30 discount. Wait, that's true.
You know that's old school, man. Nobody be doing that shit no more, man. Nowadays, bro, you spend a lot of money from your cell phone, man, from clicks on the cell phone, man.
Is there one time that you remember an item that you actually stood outside for?
I think the PS3.
You were inside the mall, way.
But I mean, it was inside the mall, but you still...
I'm talking about like outside. People got to understand Minnesota. You standing outside that Best Buy, if it's out, you know, if it's not within sight of mall, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
I remember I was standing outside Office Max, way.
What the fuck were you doing in Office
Get myself Max? A fucking laptop. You know when laptops were like so out of the like... You know, if you had a laptop, you were kind of doing pretty good.
You're doing all right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you can MySpace and Facebook on your laptop?
Nowadays, every motherfucker. Like, bro, laptops are like $300 now. Like, there's no excuse not to have a laptop.
Yeah. But now your cell phone can even do as much as a laptop, you
That's
know?
Facts.
Back then, it's like your cell phone can't do shit. You know, we had them old school cell phones. So that's what I stood in line for, way. A fucking HP laptop. I think I got like a... I'm sure it was a good discount, way. I don't remember. It was over 10 years ago, way.
Yeah.
But standing there in the cold. The only thing that I do like about Black Friday that I won't do anymore, way, because I don't know, way. You know, motherfuckers getting old out here, man. It was fun being outside, like, in the middle of the night, bro. Like, being...
It was a whole different vibe, way. Yeah. Like, that's one thing that we do gotta admit. It was a whole different vibe.
Where, the experience, you
know,
is dope.
You know, the whole experience after the Thanksgiving dinners and all that. I know we're a little late on this. Probably should have talked about this on the last episode. But, you know, you'd be looking at the ads and all that. And then everyone be talking about what stores they're going to go to. And that was a whole night event, way. Like, you know, you'd be going to the stores, way. Nowadays, it ain't like that no more, way. At least, bro, there's nothing I need, way. You know what I'm saying? Like, I got everything that I got.
What do you get a man that has it all? Yeah, I kind of felt that way, bro. But keeping it moving, talking about like everything where we're at right now, way. Like, the weather out here is changing. You know, some people,
yeah,
they really out of the Midwest space. You know, Midwest, Minnesota, and the Midwest states. It's cold already. It's cold as fuck. It's snowing like a motherfucker.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to be late to work because, you know, it takes a few tardies before you dial in that what time you got to leave. You know what I'm saying? And some people see that as irresponsible, right? Because I have motherfuckers I work with that they'll leave 45 minutes earlier just to make sure they're not late. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And me, I'm the kind of vato that is like, bro, don't you see it's snowing outside, bro? Like, you... Like, you really gonna question my fucking, like, tardiness, dude? Like, I we get that privilege now, way, because we're not living in the days of the 90s, way, where you're tardy enough, way, there's somebody right there at the door waiting to take your position, you know what I'm saying? Right now, it's like, I'm
looking for motherfuckers.
Yeah, we'll let that slide, you know?
Nah, but yeah, it's cold out here. We're in the 20s, in the lower teens, as far as the Fahrenheit. It's, we got a lot of snow, man. We, you know, we, We out here shoveling and snow blowing driveways, man, our driveways and stuff. So it's different out here, man. So to the people that live in the Southwest, West Coast, man, you guys need to appreciate that nice
East Coast. I mean,
the nice weather, man.
As far as Florida, I shouldn't say East Coast because New York, yeah. I'm sure
down
New,
south.
Yeah, down south, man.
But it's different, man. But it is what it is. With you. It comes with everything, right? California or the southwestern states, they get the beautiful weather, but of course, the cost of living is higher over there.
Ooh.
We get the lower cost of living, but we get, you know, we got to deal with these weather changes with the cold that, you know, it kind of makes up for the for all that. You know, everything balances in life. With you can't get all the pros on everything. We're like,
you can't
get to be,
can't have your cake and eat it too.
You can't have your cake and eat it too. You gotta fucking what's that thing when you gotta work with some, when you gotta
compromise,
man. You know, it's like, all right, our dollar might go further out here in Minnesota, but we're gonna have to freeze our balls off for like 6 months. You know what I mean?
You gotta hibernate, way, you know. And that's the thing about, you know, some people that when they got their money right, you know, that's the direction we heading in, you know. But they out, you know, comes fucking November way, they going to their crib that they stay all winter, and then they come back over here in the summertime. You know what I'm saying?
They call them snowbirds or
something.
Yeah,
like that? Yeah, snowbirds, you know, because they're going down south. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? But usually it's retired folks, yeah. You know, for the most part. There's younger people that are able to do it. But that's one of my goals too, you know what I'm saying? Like, just get situated, so be able to enjoy. Because we do like some of the winter shit, you know what I mean? Like look at you. You look cozier than the motherfucker,
hey,
you know?
Hey, man. That's
you look beauty. Like you want to be cuddled and shit.
Stay away, what?
I just fucking
Nah, you know, like, you know, with everything, with the season changes comes wardrobe changes and you know, different styles of shoes. You put boots on now. And
oh, you got the Timbs on?
Got the Timbs on, man.
Okay,
so it's like,
I see you.
You can take advantage of the changes way, the season changes way. Like, you know, when I was when we were in Florida, you see, you go to the outlets over there, and they're selling fall clothing and winter clothing, like they're really going to experience a winter like we do out here in the Midwest or the East Coast, like, you know, like New York or something like that. But it's like, you don't get it like that, you know what I mean? So it's dope to be able to have different wardrobe changes, because there's different styles for everything, man. And you know, gotta change is good, way. Change is good.
Change makes you appreciate all the seasons of the year, you know what I'm saying?
But yeah, man, but talking about, you know, being down in Florida, man, I was recently, you know, I recently took the family, or I shouldn't say I took the family, but, you know, me and my wife, you know, we planned.
Own that shit. You're the man of the house, aren't you?
Mandilon. Me and my wife, you know, we made a plan, man.
It was
a
team effort, guys.
We set a goal, man. Nah, on some real shit. We set a goal to go on a family vacation way. And I can honestly tell you right now that this is like our first family vacation. You know what I mean? Like, we have gone to Mexico before for a wedding and stuff, but that's not like a vacation, because you're going down there for a wedding. You're just hanging out with family. I mean, it is somewhat of a vacation, but it's
getaway of some sort.
But yeah, but it's not like you know, just for a different reason that's different from being with like celebrating a family event. So we had planned that out, man. You know, we was trying to do something like that, you know. So we wanted to take the kids out to Disney World, and it's like, my daughter, she's 6 years old, so we feel like, you know, my daughter's 6 years old, my son's three, so we feel like, you know, obviously, like, Disney has a lot to do with princesses. It has a lot to do with the, you know, that magic,
the cartoons that they love,
yeah,
right?
The cartoons and the whole magic of believing and all that cartoon stuff and the fantasy of, you know, all that princess and stuff. So I'm like, a lot of people are like, why take your kids so young? They're not going to even remember it. You know what I mean? But it's like,
I will.
God did. but it's like at the same time, like, I don't want to wait till she's like, let's say 10. And then she's already like, yeah, this ain't real. Or like, okay. You know, like, it ain't that special no more. You know what I mean? Like, that excitement ain't fully there no more.
Yeah.
So
Let them still. You're taking her at an age where some things are still like fantasy believable, of some sort, right?
Yeah. So we had planned it out, man, and you know, of course, it all happened during, you know, one of the worst times of our lives, you know. But everything was scheduled. Everything was you know, already set in stone. So, you know, it was actually a couple weeks after my mom passed away, you know. So, you know, we had to just kind of like stick with the plan, even though things were obviously, you know, not at the best times of our lives, you know. But it's one of those things that we talked about that is like you gotta keep going forward for your kids and all that.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, it was dope, man. We was able to get out there. You know, we stayed out in Orlando for 4 nights. 5 days, and it was dope, man. We went to Disney World 2 days out of those 5 days. We went to the Magic Kingdom, we went to the Animal Kingdom, and it was very dope, man. It was dope to see to just be there as a family, the kids just enjoying themselves, just being able to experience something like Disney World, bro. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, we see that on TV. You know, we're watching TV and we see that on commercials. We see that. You know, all that on commercials and stuff, and we were always watching Disney. So to finally be there in person, it was very dope, man. It's kind of like as a parent, you're there enjoying the moment, you're watching your kids have fun, but you're also like in the back of your mind, or maybe, you know, some of us, we just think about it more than others, mm-hmm. but it's like in the back of your mind, you're just like taking it all in, and you're like, damn. We did this, you know, like, you know, like God, like gave us permission, to be able to be here and do all this, you know, that allowed us to be able to experience all this, you know? So
yeah,
just being super grateful, man, throughout the whole trip, man, like everything we're doing as far as Disney World, and everything else, man. And it was just cool, man, because, you see all the families, see all the kids. And it's dope to be able to provide something like that for your kids, man. You know, and like something that we didn't really experience as kids ourselves. You know, like mm-hmm. when us growing up, it's different. You know, when you're coming from like a straight up immigrant family, you don't, you know, we don't experience family vacations. You know, that's not something that we really experience. So for me and my wife to be able to provide this for our family, for our kids, it was very dope, man. And we don't take that for granted, you know. Everything is appreciated from the flights to Disney, to going to the beach, to going to all the touristy areas, bro. It's just you can't explain it away. You're providing your kids and you're giving them experiences that you wish you had as a child, but you know that you're providing them experiences that is gonna change their lives. Mm. It's gonna change their lives, and it's gonna let them realize, like, man, like everything's possible. Like like they're not missing out on anything in life, you know, because when we were kids, we used to hear kids coming back from vacation and like, oh, we went to Disneyland, oh, we went over here, we went over there, we never went anywhere, you know what I mean? like oh, what do you guys do for summer vacation? It's like, we didn't go anywhere. We were just,
we got to sleep in and watch cartoons all fucking day.
Exactly, you know. So it's like, at my daughter's school, you know, she's always saying, oh, my friend's not going to school this week because they're going to Disneyland or to Disney World or to Mexico or, you know, different countries. Mm. And it is like, I thank God every day. I thank God for giving me the opportunity to be able to provide stuff like this for my child too, because she doesn't feel left out. You know, she's like, in her mind, it's like, oh, cool, it's your turn. You're going this week.
Yeah.
I went last week, or I'm going next week. You know, it's like, it's not like, dang, my family, we can't afford to do stuff like that, and I gotta lie about doing certain things, because, you know, it's sad to say, but we all, like, us kids that came from immigrant families, like first ones here, we all lied once in a while, like, oh yeah, I got the new Nintendo, or I got the new Super Nintendo, or I got this, or we went here, we went there. Like, my daughter, she don't gotta lie about that stuff, man. So it's dope, man.
And in a way, también, way, you know, it's dope that you got to experience all that stuff and you know, setting that as family goals and family experiences is dope, way. You know what I mean? That's gangster shit, you know, as adults, way. But you're setting like an abundant mindset, también, you know what I mean? For your guys, for you and your wife, but also for the kids, you know what I mean? Because when people say like they're too young, they're not going to remember, they're really just saying like save your money, don't waste your money, because it's going to be a waste because they're not even going to remember, right? That's kind of like what it's translating to.
Yeah.
And if you let that be that, you're thinking in a scarcity mindset, like, oh yeah, you're right, I'm going to waste my one shot of Disney World or Disneyland on this time. But what are we moving now is like, all right, I'm going to go now and then we're going to go again.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? This is, it's, you know, there's not a limit access to Disney World. Like, dude, you've been here already, dude. I remember in 2022, you brought your kids and that's the limit, buddy. Nah, like you can go as many times as you want.
Because there's different things you do at different ages. Wade.
Yeah.
Like, you know, right now my kids can't, they can't go on the bigger rides, you know, they can't go on certain things because they're scared.
So and their emotions are different too. Wade. Like your daughter's going to show different emotions to what she sees now than what she sees in 2 years. Mm-hmm. Your son's going to be able to take everything in to his capacity. And then when you take him in 2 years, it's going to be different. You know what I mean? So us as adults, us as the parents, I should say, when we see that, we're like enjoying that part of it. You know what I mean? That's our fun. It's like, oh, let's see what his face or let's see what their emotions are.
Reactions.
Yeah. Hell yeah. You know what I mean? You want to witness all this stuff. You want to take pictures. You want to take some videos.
That's when the money's worth, Wade. Like, you know, when they say oh, the flights were this much, the hotels were this much, the tickets to Disney World were this much. But it's like the reaction on your kids' faces and the smiles on your kids' faces, that's priceless, way. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
As cheesy as that shit sounds,
oh, way, it's cheesy as fuck.
Yeah, it's cheesy, way. But that's some real shit, way.
Like, it is.
When you see the smiles on your kids' faces, when you see the reaction, when you see that emotion, you're like, man, all that money was worth it just right there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it was very dope, man. It was a very dope experience, man. And it's like, just being able to be there, even as adults, way, like, you know, just experiencing it as adults and seeing like, you know, I don't know, way, being so, I've never been to Disney World, you know, my first time. So it's like just experiencing something like that with your kids.
You didn't run up to Mickey Mouse and like start hugging the motherfucker.
Nah. But it's like, it's dope, way, because you see people from, it's like people from all around the world, way, show up at this place, way. So it's like, you see different, cultures, different families, but we're all sharing that same joy. You know, this is going to be a cheesy episode. This is going to be a cheesy episode.
Yo, if y'all don't want cheesiness, man, just stop this shit right now.
But we got to keep it real. We're like, we all there for the same purpose of giving our kids some really good memories and a really good time, way. You know, and at the same time, we create memories, right?
It's different type of flexes, way. You know what I mean? Sometimes you flex with your girl. Sometimes you flex with the whip. Sometimes you flex with the new outfit you go and you go out.
Mm.
Being a parent or being a dad, or I'm sure the moms feel the same way too, it's a flex when you're out there and be like, yo, look at them. They brought their kids out here. That's a flex too, you know what I mean? Like, they out here doing this shit for their kids, you know what I'm saying? That's a flex.
Yeah.
And I think we need a take some pride in that, you know, and be like, oh shit,
you
like
know, plus we went with the matching outfits and all that, man, you know.
Oh, that was real cheesy.
You could tell you from the hood when you match all your shit, you know. It's like it's hard not to look like you from the hood when you're like, we gotta match the shirts with the shoes, with the shorts, with the
that shit was cute, man. I'm too hood for that shit,
Lazy,
bro.
Never tell me that shit was cute again.
We ain't matching nothing, bro. As soon as I get a idea, my girl wants to match some shit, bro, I'm stopping that right there on the track.
Nah, bro, you get a pass at certain places. Disney World, you get a pass to match. But there's, you know, there's a lot of people matching the shirts. There's
did your shirt say dad?
Yeah. Yo, man, I was in my full dad vibes, man.
I'm the dad. The dad. Motherfucking dad over here.
Nah, man, but it was a very dope time, way. But it's like, as a parent, way, you realize it's like it takes work to provide a good time, way. You know, it's not like you just get there and your kids are on their best behavior. Your kids are in their best with their best attitude or their best, you know, they're like happy all the time. Nah, you got to deal with it and you got to work with it and you got to be patient with it because like kids get tired with it. Kids throw tantrums, kids, you know, whatever. And you got to just overcome that and work around it and provide and still somehow bring it back in, get the regroup and have a good time with it because
kids are different these days.
Kids are kids, way.
If you would have taken us to Disney World, if my parents would have taken us to Disney World at that age, 6, I don't even know if we could have a bad attitude, way. You know what I'm saying?
We wouldn't, way.
I don't know what you would need to do.
We would just be super quiet and be like, oh, what are we going to do now, mom? Like, okay, you want to do that? Let's go do that. Like, whatever you want to do, let's go do it.
Yeah.
Nowadays, you know.
I don't want to go there.
Yeah. Like,
I'm hungry.
You know, so that's one thing, right? So, I mean, the whole Disney World trip was dope, man. We had nothing but a dope experience. My kids were able to experience something, you know, real special. We're obviously, as the parents, going to remember that, you know, that vacation as something special. Plus, you know, like I said, we went and did other cool terrorist stuff. No, mine was we went and did other cool tourist stuff, you know. So it was a lot of dope stuff, man. But I do want to talk about how it's different from our kids to when we were kids, you know, because, you know, this is my first time at Disney World, you know, but we have been to Disneyland, you know, me and you, you know, we went to Disneyland when we were like 11 or 12 years old. And the difference, one of the differences that I do want to point out to the people that listen to us is, like, we come from, like I said, a straight immigrant family from Mexico. But we're not just like four people in a family, you know. We're a total of 9 people in a family. Mm. So imagine back then gathering up a family of 9 and being like, we're going to take a family vacation to Disneyland. Like, that's not easy to come by, right?
Nah.
So what our mom used to do, our mom and dad used to do, is they would take turns with us. You know, like one summer, they would send our two sisters down to Chicago, to California, with our family down in California, and then our family in California would take them to Disneyland, to Universal Studios, to Knott's Berry Farm, and all that stuff, and then they would come back, and then the next summer, you know, we take turns, you know, we go down in pairs like that. And then that's how me and you ended up going. We went down there when we're like 11,
3 months.
Yeah, we went down there for a whole summer and we went to Disneyland. We actually went to Disneyland twice that summer because we went with two different family members.
Went to Six Flags.
We went to Universal Studios. Yeah. We went to Knott's Berry Farm.
Before the Edgars took over it.
before it got dangerous, you know.
Edgar.
So we did all that, you know, but it was dope because we were able to hang out with our tías and our tíos and our cousins, and we went to Disneyland and all that and all the other ones. It was dope. It was a good time. We were kids and we were enjoying ourselves, you know. It's something all the kids dream of going to, right? But it's different because you're not there with your brothers and your sisters, and you're not there with your mom and dad. So
yeah, that's crazy you mentioned that, because it's a whole, and I don't even know if we took time to even understand that when we were kids. You know, we were only like 10.
Yeah.
But we weren't there with our parents, you know. There wasn't that mutual emotion of happiness, you know, like kind of like you experience it now. Like, you take your kids, they're smiling and happy, and you have to match them at their energy, right? That's kind of what parents do. Yeah. We didn't have that.
And our parents basically had to hear, and back then the you know, it wasn't like cell phones
were FaceTime
or pictures or cell phones were so, you know, there was no cell phones like that. So it was not like you could take all these pictures and video of how your kids are reacting.
Yeah.
So our parents basically had to imagine how much fun we're having, since, you know, like, oh, I'm sure my kids are having a lot of fun right now. They're in Disneyland. And then your tía would tell them about it, like, oh yeah, they had fun. But they didn't see that emotion, you know. You didn't have that those experiences, like, you know, that you didn't share those moments with your parents. But our parents did the best that they could to provide us with those moments that they felt like kids should experience. So when we were kids, you don't really think much of it. We're like, oh, cool, my mom sent us to California to spend time with her family. And we ended up going to all these places. But it's like, as you get older, you're like, you know, you start realizing like, oh, yeah, our parents couldn't afford for all of us to go down to down there together. So we had to take turns. Mm-hmm. And it's a different way because it's just things that you that all kids wish they could have experienced with their family, with mm-hmm. their parents. But you can't, you know.
And it's crazy way because it's like, I don't know if the whole world is getting soft, man. You know, we need to listen more Andrew Tate, man. We need
Top G.
That fucking Smiley's daddy over here. We need to harden the fuck up. You know what I mean?
We're saying that shit, man. People are going to believe that, man.
Because my mom, she would send us with my tios and tias, like all of the brothers and sisters, right? Mm-hmm. And the primos were the same way. You know, they'd come visit us for whole summers and shit. Mm-hmm. I don't know about you, man, but I ain't sending my daughter somewhere for a whole summer. You know?
I ain't sending my son or daughter nowhere.
And that's just, I think that's just the difference in culture way. And I think that's just the difference of information that now we have the options to do. Like, you want to go to Disney World? We going. You know what I mean? You want to do this? We going.
We have the options way, but también, like, I think our generation... We heard so many stories.
We have too much information, bro.
We heard so many stories about our peers or other families that went through things, and we're like, "I ain't gonna put my kid in the way of the possibility of something happening to him." So, you know, you stay clear of that.
Yeah. So, but you know, going back to when we were kids, like our parents didn't have the options. Like, if they wanted us to go, we would kind of tag along, right? Because, you know, if one of the tios is taking their kids or a prima's taking their kids, my mom or dad would look at the opportunity and be like, who knows how that conversation took place? Mm-hmm. Like, y no hay espacio para que uno de mis hijos vayan, you know? Oh, pues sí, you know, boom, right there. Yeah. It gets created. ¿Y cuánto va a ser? Oh, pues, you know, boom, boom, boom. They probably give the fetty, you know, it's like, yo, this should be enough to cover their trip and their entrance and shit like that.
But that's what, you know, experiences like that is what causes us to appreciate everything mm-hmm. we get in life. Way like every time when we were kids and on this specific trip when we went to all those places, we appreciated our tías and our tíos and our cousins taking us to these places. We were on our best behavior. We whatever they wanted to do, that's what we did. You know, like back in the day,
we're good old Christian boys.
We're good old Christian boys. But what I was gonna say is like, we would our tías, they would pack lunches away. You know what I mean? It's not like we're eating in Disneyland, or it's not like we're eating in Knott's Berry Farm. We would go back to the cars and we would eat our sandwiches or whatever.
But our tías are straight from Mexico, bro. So them tortas were something different, bro.
Right. But I'm saying like we would go back to the cars, we would eat, and then we go back inside. Like it's different. Like that's why we appreciate everything. From everything that God has blessed us with, we appreciate it.
We notice the difference way. Yeah. We've experienced what it is to go from like a carcachita to a all leather interior car. It's like, how can we not notice a difference, right? That's kind of what our life has been. It's like we've experienced of having to do things without our parents or having to everything that we've gone through to now that we're doing it. And it's like at a different scale. And it's like, oh, man, I can't. Like you taking your kids to Disney World is like, oh, my experience was nothing like this.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's not like, you know, some people might be like, oh, wait, la están pensando mucho, ways, you know, just fucking live your life, man. No, it's like, this is a burnt memory. It's a core memory of mine mm-hmm. that I think about when I think about my childhood. And I think about, we got pictures in Disney World and I mean, Disneyland and Universal Studios and shit. Those are core memories of ours. You know, when we think about happy childhood memories, it's like, oh, that one time we went to Disney. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But we know the difference now to where our kids, their experiences are a lot different way. You know, and that's
the goal. You know, it's the goal. Obviously, our parents work hard to get us to where we're at today, and we work hard to get our kids to a better place than we are. But it's like back when we went, we were eating our lunches at the car, right? We go back to the car and we eat our lunches, we go back in. now that I went, we weren't eating lunches in the car. Mm. We're eating at the restaurants at Disney World. You know what I mean? So our kids are not seeing the struggle. You know what I mean? So it's like, at the same time, you're like, thank you, God, for providing me with the luxury of being able to buy my kids their meals at Disney World, buy them snacks, buy them ice cream, whatever. We don't have to go back to the car and eat and then come back in. You know what I mean? It's like, but at the same time, you kind of think back. You're like our kids are not getting that struggle. They don't know about the struggle. So will they fully appreciate everything they get in life? Mm. You know? And it's like,
how hungry are they going to be?
How hungry and how much will they appreciate everything in life? You know what I mean? Like, so it's one of those things that you kind of struggle with, because it's like, we get to enjoy the nicer things in life. You know, I'm not saying that we're doing the best in life or we are where we want to be, but every little thing that we get, we appreciate it. You know what I mean? Like, it just makes you think, like, will our kids appreciate everything that they get in life? Like, even this trip, like, I feel like sometimes, like, my kids don't see this trip as like, oh my God, thank you for, like, thank you, God, for providing us this opportunity to go to Disney World.
Yeah.
To them, it's like, why wouldn't we go to Disney World? Like,
all my classmates went already.
To them, it was like, well, I knew it was just a matter of time before you guys took us. I mean, why why wouldn't we be able to afford that? Like, they don't know that a plan comes behind it, saving money comes behind it. And it's not like we balling like that to like just be throwing money away like that.
Yeah.
It's a plan that comes behind it. But, you know, we don't like to show obviously you ain't going to show your kids the whole process. You just go, you know, but they grew up thinking like, why wouldn't we have a nice house? Why wouldn't we have nice cars? Why wouldn't we go to Disney World? Why wouldn't we go to these two nice restaurants? Mm-hmm. Why wouldn't you guys buy me a toy at this store? You know what I mean? Like, they see it as like, if you don't buy it, sometimes they see it as like, if you don't buy it for me, it's because you just don't want to buy it for me. Mm-hmm. It ain't because you don't got the money. And sometimes, like, I do bring that up. I'll be like, oh, we don't got money for that right now. Just so they can, learn to value the dollar way, you know?
It's not in the budget. It's not in the budget right now, you know? And, you know, just doing shit like that, bro, sometimes you got to do some ghetto shit, you know what I mean? And I'm not saying, like, ghetto, super ghetto, but... Like, I'd be taking, you know, this is Minnesota winter. We just talked. Like, I'd be taking my daughter to either Target or Walmart and just walking the aisles and playing with toys in the aisle. You know, we ain't necessarily buying shit. You know what I'm saying? And again, my daughter's too little to even understand anything. But you got to let them know they can't have everything tampoco way. They got to have some kind of, there has to be some kind of boundaries of or some kind of lines that you set. Or it's like, you're not going to get it all, but tampoco, we're not going to not let you have what you really want, you know, if that makes sense, you know?
No, and through all this way, it reminds me of this thing, you know, I kind of been on TikTok a lot lately, but some real shit be popping up on
this. Welcome to the dark side, brother.
And there was this one video way that popped up with like this, you know, a lot of videos have like this voiceover, you mm-hmm, know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And then there was this voiceover that said, tough times create tough people. Tough people create easy times. Hmm. And then easy times create weak people. And then weak people create tough times. And then those tough times will create strong people, tough people again. And it's a cycle.
Yeah.
So it's like our parents, we lived through a tough time because our parents immigrated here we all immigrated here to America and we struggled. We lived tough times. And it created us as tough people.
We didn't speak the English.
So then us as tough kids, tough people, we're creating easier times for our kids, mm-hmm. which our kids are not going to know the struggle. So
sheltering your kids or sheltering your loved ones, you're not, for the most part, you're not doing them any good by it.
Yeah.
But by the amount of love that you have for them, you can't help it. You know what I'm saying? It's like I went through that and I survived it because I'm a tough motherfucker. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? We think that to ourselves, but they're probably easily as tough, you know? But we just don't want them to go through that. Like, We don't want you to go through this pain. We don't want you to go through this heartbreak. We don't want you to go through this failure.
Yeah.
We don't want you to go through this decepción. You know what I mean? Like, oh.
Yeah.
You know? But at the same time, we have to learn how to let them lose. We have to learn how to let them get hurt. We have to
face reality with.
Yeah. Not like hurt to like an extent, but like they say, like, your kids are smart enough that they will, they will, like, when they're playing, like our little kids, way, they're playing to their best capacity way. And if you're always protecting them from falling or like bumping their head, you're not going to let them learn the way that they're meant to. You know what I mean? It's like, you have to let them get back up and do it the right way next time, you know, instead of being like, hey, stop. You know what I mean? So it's basically sheltering way, you know what I mean? And that's going to be a thing that our generation, because a lot of the people that are in our generation way, we weren't really sheltered. You know what I mean? We lived the rough way. Like that's why there's videos of us sleeping on chairs at a party or in, you know, on a couch outside while everybody's hanging out till 5 a.m. Like, we lived rough, bro.
But not just that way. Not just that. Like, yeah, that's like that typical thing of like the kids sleeping while the parents are partying and stuff at a quinceañera or something.
We used to.
But that's different way. Like, it's different from the fact of like, while your parents were working all day long, and then when you came home from school, you had to just stay home, and the older brother or sister had to take care of the little brothers and sisters and feed them and go to bed on time to go to school the next day when there was no supervision at home. The struggle was, you go to a bank and you got to translate for your parent that doesn't know how to speak English. The struggle is, you know, your parents don't got the money to buy you the nicer clothes to go to school and they will at least match with your peers. You know, we go every one of those things, they create tough people, right? Because we gone through it, we dealt with those emotions, we felt that humiliation, we felt that
embarrassment, right?
Yeah. we felt left out. So it's like, we know those feelings, and then we grow up and we're like, I'm never gonna let my kids feel like that again. And it's like, and that's that cycle that I had just mentioned. It's like, that is like, we got to do our best to still somewhat always remind our kids where we come from. You know, like, you don't physically or through experiences, they don't got to physically experience the struggle, but always mentioning to them like, hey, you know, well, you know where I was born, and you know how, you know, when we got here, this and that. You know, as they grow in age, I feel like you got to share experiences and some of the struggles so they can at least understand it and appreciate everything they have in life through all the hard work that was done before them. You know what I mean? Because if we go through life way and we don't tell our kids how our parents came, how we came and how we came up or how we grew up, then they go through life thinking that they've never had no struggles, and that's when they don't appreciate. You know, I feel like that's when you don't appreciate a lot of things, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And that's tough, right? That's tough to, like, these teachings, you know what I mean? That we get the responsibility as parents that we have to learn how to deliver of, like, we're not broke, but we also can't give you everything.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's like, we don't want to give you this, like, poor mentality of, like, scarcity, where it's like, where it's also not good, you know what I mean? Because you could affect them in a different way. You give them too much, then you affect them in a different way. Yeah. Or it's like, how do we balance all this? Like, too much iPad, you know, too much toys of the ones that you want. You know what I mean? It's like, it's not easy way. It's not easy, but at least we're trying to do it consciously and we're aware of what we're trying to do. I think one of the biggest things that we're trying to do is give our kids experiences that we never had, but also experiences that we see a lot of the kids in their age groups living, experiencing. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, you know, our parents and especially our mom used to be like, you know, do it para que no te estén contando cómo fue. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, experience it yourself. You know what I'm saying? Like, and that's what I want to do for my daughter. Way is like, we're gonna do it all way, but you also have to hold a standard of like how you have to also let them know, like not you don't got to get extreme with it, but you got to let them know it was a lot of work to make this happen. You know what I mean? And as the kids get older, I think we've mentioned it before, ways like you got to make them part of the plan. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's like, hey, where would you like to go to vacation this year? Mm-hmm. Let's just say they say SeaWorld or something. All right. Well, let's think of a plan. Even if the plan's not going to be all accurate to their knowledge at that point, but you make it work and make them feel like they were a big factor of how the plan worked out. You know what I mean? Like, you want this new video game, but that might affect us going to SeaWorld. Oh, you're right. So let's not buy that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So you know, it's not, it doesn't sound dope conversationally, but it's something that you have to do as a parent too.
It's like part of like you got to sacrifice a little bit to get that bigger goal, to accomplish that bigger goal.
And people have to know that there is like, como se dice, like, I can't even think of the fucking word, way. But you need to leave something to be able to get to where you want to get to, right? Like, you want SeaWorld, so we can't go to this water park.
You got
to
sacrifice
something, right? Yeah. I hate the word sacrifice, right? Because some people say it's like it leaves like a bad taste, like you're suffering just to get somewhere. You know what I mean? But let's not get too deep into that.
Yeah. No, but you know, my goal, man, is to every year take a family vacation away. When we were growing up, that's something that was not even part of a conversation with. You know what I mean?
Every year,
take a vacation somewhere. Yeah. And as I feel like as the kids get older, the destinations change. You know what I mean? Because obviously everything needs to be age appropriate for whatever age your kids are at. But it's like, that's something I want to add to my family. You know, I want to add to something that we do. And you know, like we were talking about, like that's something that was not ever in the conversation as kids. We didn't do stuff like that. Like we stayed local. You know what I mean? Like everything our parents did for us, we stayed local. We didn't go too far. You know, like we share with a lot of people. We grew up in Oregon, grew up in a small town called the Dalles, which when we were going to go, like when we felt like we were going to really go do something dope, it's like we drive to Portland. Or we drive to Clackamas, you know.
Which is like an hour away, right?
Yeah, like an hour and a half or something like that. And then that was like, oh, shit, that's dope. We're going to go to the big city. We're going to go to the mall. And then we're going to go shopping. And that was a dope time, you know.
Yeah.
But you know, we grew up poor, but we grew up happy. There was never, I don't ever remember as a kid being bummed out because I was poor. Like, I wasn't like, damn, I hate being poor. Or like, like, why can't we do that? I hate being poor. Like, why do we have to be poor? Like, that was never like, that's something that never came out of my mouth.
It
was
oh,
like,
Dios, esta maldita vida de pobre.
Maldita pobreza. So that's not something that we complained about. It was like, oh shit, like we had a raggedy ass soccer ball and we'd be out with the neighborhood kids and we'd be playing soccer. We'd be drinking water out of the hose, you know. We'd be riding bikes, like our first bikes. They were girl bikes.
But hey, man, you ain't got to share that part, bro.
They were girl bikes.
They were low riders, Holmes. That's how the frame looks on the low lows.
You know, they were girl bikes, and our older bro painted them blue just so they could look like boy bikes. But that's how poor we were. But that's
we were happy as fuck with them girl bikes. We were happy as
kids, man. You know what I mean? Like, playing soccer, playing with our friends, riding bikes with our friends, just doing the basic childhood stuff, way, like that kept us happy. Way.
We had a good childhood, way, because we also grew up in a nice small town. Shout out to Oregon, man. I know a lot of people that we grew up with rock with the podcast, way. But you know, one main thing that we grew up with, way, it was way like love, bro, like cariño. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like that's one thing that whether you're broke, love, you're going to remember that, and that's going to overpower your situation.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you're doing good, like you're taking your kids to Disneyland, they're not going to remember most of the rides. They're going to remember more of the experience with you guys, the love, the cariño, mm-hmm. as a family, you know what I mean? So, and everybody who, whatever situation that you are in life, your kids just want to be with you, you know what I'm saying? Your kids just want to have fun. They want to experience that stuff with you. So I think wherever people are at in their process, it's all going to be dope, boy, as long as you're there as a family. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. We experienced it from the bottom. Now we're starting to experience things at a different level, but we don't forget where we came from.
Yeah.
And we just going to keep that tradition alive, boy, as far as like just be there with your kids, give them that time, give them those experiences, boy. And I think that's what's going to count, boy. I think that's what counts, bro.
Yeah, man. Just giving them those experiences, man. And I feel like, you know, I feel like me and you, we kind of stress on this a lot, but I think it has to do a lot with how we came up and some of the discrimination that we experienced as kids. But it's like we always were told, like, Mexicans don't do that. Mexicans can't afford that. Mexicans can't do this. Mexicans don't go on vacations. So it's like, I think that's one of my
dirty wet back.
that's one of the things too, man. That's like that's one of those things that pushed me to keep working harder, right? And that's one of the things that I want my kids to be proud of, being Mexican American, and then to never feel like people can ever put them down, because there's like, what do you mean Mexicans don't do that? I go here and we go there and we do this and we do that. We do everything everybody else does. You know what I mean? Like, I never want them to feel like they're lesser than anybody. Like, I want them to be like, I don't know, man. I don't want to get too deep on it, but it's like, I just never want them to feel like that they can't do certain things because of their background, or they'll be able to be like, well, what are you guys talking about? Like, we do all the same thing you guys do. You know, like, you guys must be getting your information wrong from like your parents, because it's different. They ain't even gonna know it's different, because my kids ain't even gonna know the difference. But it's gonna be like, what are you guys talking about? Like, we do this and we do that too. You know what I mean? So I know it's one of them things that a lot of people won't understand. It really depends on where you grew up. I mean, because a lot of the people, we got a lot of listeners from California, and sometimes in California you grew up with a lot of other Mexicans. So it's like, it's just, you don't have them
experiences. Mexicans on Mexicans.
Yeah, you don't have them experiences of like we grew up in Oregon, like we said, and it was a bunch of white Caucasian kids, you know, and we were always being told like, oh yeah, you guys are Mexicans, your parents do this, or you guys can't do that, or you guys don't do this. And we always felt like, damn, like, yeah, we're, you know, we can't afford to do shit like that, or yeah, we don't do shit like that.
You know, I hate that, how that affected us, way. You know,
I hate it too.
I hate that we experienced that, because even as adults, in the back of your mind, it's just there. You know what I'm saying?
And I think that's how a lot of minorities, we grew up. We grew up looking poor and not doing things the middle class did, or a lot of the white Caucasian kids did, and that's why a lot of brown and black people, bro, we're like, we want the nicest clothes, and we want to always keep it clean. We want to always match our clothes so we can look like we got money. We're gonna buy the new car, and then the with the big wheels and add all kinds of shit so we can look like money everywhere we're at.
Yeah.
Even though maybe sometimes your financial situation ain't looking the best, like you ain't got no cash flow coming in, you ain't got no good investments, but it's like, while I'm out here, you guys are just seeing money. I'm living like,
don't ask me what I do for a living, motherfucker.
Yeah, like, you know, so I feel like that's where a lot of that came from. Like, that's why we always worry so much about how we dress, how we look, what car we drive, all that stuff, because it's like we want to show that we're successful, right?
Yeah.
Your clothes and your car shows how successful you are. And as we get older, obviously, we know success is a whole different level than that. But it's like, as far as our kids, I think that's one thing that we show, that we want to show how successful we are too. If that's where you're at, right? Like, you take your kids on vacation, you take your family on vacation, you're showing a little bit of success there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But that's true. Overall, man, that's just how we're living right now, man. You know, and I just wanted to share that. Just some of our experiences, recent experiences and our past experiences, and how that comes together, and how all of our experiences in life as immigrant kids, as Mexican kids, affect the decisions and the things we do today. You know what I mean? Because a lot of the discrimination, it cuts deep, and you don't even show it because we hide it with this tough guy persona. We hide it with this gangster persona.
We hide it with being quiet. You know what I mean? We hide it by keeping to ourselves. But at the same time, now that we're doing shit, is like we have this like. I think it instills some kind of insecurity in some people, you know, because obviously a lot of people grew up in different environments and different scenarios. Mm-hmm. But we have like this insecurity way because it's like, look, I can do it too, motherfucker. Yeah. You know what I mean? Isn't that an insecurity?
It is.
Where it's like, look what I'm driving, motherfucker. But or look where I'm living.
Yeah. But it's like, we do that so our kids don't have to feel that. Yeah. You know what I mean? And it's like,